I think it's the last session for today. I'll be both chairing it and doing the first presentation. So if I'm running out of time, I you give me a hint. Welcome. I just noticed the title of my presentation doesn't really fit the title which is on the schedule. I changed it at some point. But don't worry, the content is still the same. It's still in there. So there will be ClickHouse, there will be Postgres, there's floating car data. And my my main point will be how to deal with all the data and what can you get from it. Okay, first a bit about what I'm going to speak about. How does that look? A lot of car data. How do you store that kind of data? It is really quite something. And last thing, and that's the nicest part, what to get from it. And there will be a bit of R. I promised R, right? In the, yeah, okay. I have some pictures with R. I know there's not too much code, unfortunately. First, the context. My name is Tom van Tilburg. I work for Geodan, a company in the Netherlands. And we have a project together with a national body that collects traffic data. Actually, it is 19 public bodies together. It's municipalities, it's semi-governmental organizations, and they all store their traffic data in one location, which they use for traffic management information, some analysis, especially that analysis part we are involved in, and we got the opportunity to do some experiments with that data. Okay, what is road data or floating car data? Basically, you can put that into three categories. You have the incidents, which are locations along or on the road where something happens. It could be an accident, could be a bridge that opens, could be events which are already planned ahead. You have sensors, which is obviously like they measure the speed, they measure how many cars pass by, they can even measure how big the car is, how many wheels it has, and how fast it goes from A to B if you have cameras, for instance. And you have floating car data, which is a bit different. That's the data you get from like TomTom devices, or you get it from Google if you have a Google with your location on in your pockets, and then it might track you. That's usually only speed, because the numbers of that are not very reliable. About those sensors, I think you've all seen the sensor in the road. It's like these black lines where they can measure how many vehicles pass. If you have two of these sensors behind each other, like here, they're putting it in the road, they can also measure speed. And there's quite a lot of them. This is the situation around Amsterdam. And every red dot you see in the map is one sensor. Actually, it's multiple sensors usually, because multiple lanes next to each other form one location. Over the whole country, it's roughly 14,000 of them. You have from one to up to six lanes, I believe, per sensor. And they measure the speed and the flow for every minute. That is only for the main roads. As you see, the underlying roads in the center have very few points, only a couple of them. That doesn't mean they're not being measured, because every traffic light has a kind of measurement in it. It just means they're not centralized in one database. So roughly every 500 meters on the road, you pass one sensor on the highway. The nice thing about this, it's open data. You can download it. It's XML. It's a format which is unreadable, called DATEX 2. But if you read the documents and you know a bit how to handle, you can derive quite a lot of data from it, which is nice. Now, there's also floating car data. As I said, these are the little things in your car which measure, which show you where you are, where you go, but they also send that information to a central server, and companies can buy that if they like. So what they did, that they bought a big set of floating car data from a provider, which covers roughly 400,000 kilometers of road in the Netherlands. That's about 10 million segments. Every segment is about 50 meters long. And that's aggregated per minute. Unfortunately, because the data is commercially sold, it's closed source. This gives you a bit of idea about the road network in the Netherlands. This is every road that exists. That includes the little roads on the dikes where nobody goes, but they're still in there, and theoretically they're being measured. And if you would collect all the floating car data, and how much is that? This gives a bit of an idea. It is 750,000 records a minute. That is about 1 billion records a day. That roughly translates to 250 gigabytes per month. That would be 3 terabytes a year if you store that. on top of that, there's monthly, they provide a new road network. A new road network means can be changes in the road. That's about 10 million segments, and it should be a routable network, of course. How do we store that? Because obviously, you need that to use them together. The first thought is you put everything in a normal, relational, JS-enabled database, which is obviously, in this case, Postgres with PostJS on it. That was our first thought, because it has PostJS, which we all know and love. It has a PG routing on it, which you get routing kind of for free in it. And it has an enormous amount of indexing options on it, which is interesting because it's time series data, which needs different kind of indexing than normal. Only thing is, it gets a little bit problematic, this kind of database, if it doesn't fit into memory anymore, these indexes, and they don't after some time. Now, there's something new. There's also ClickHouse database. It is made by Yandex. Yandex is the Russian Google. It is open source, not very long time ago, as far as I know. And it is a columnar store database. Who has heard of a columnar database? Okay. For those who didn't, a columnar database, I'll explain a bit later, but it's a slightly different way of storing your data, which is not very suitable for transactions or updates, which means you're just putting your data in and reading it, but never change anything about it. And it's very suitable for analysis on very large databases, which roughly look the same over time. And it compresses pretty well for free. Now, what is column storage? Imagine this old-fashioned LP player, where you put the data on one track, and it just plays, loops all the time. If you have a normal database, normal like in Postgres database, you start record by record, you put it. So first you put one record, then you continue with the next one. If you want to skip from the first record to the millionth record, you have to skip that whole track until you reach the millionth. Columnar is a bit different. They first take the first column, put that all after each other, and only then they start with the second. And the nice thing is you can hop very quickly from the first column to the second one, which gives a very quick way of skipping through your data. What doesn't work if you want to remove data in the middle, because then you have to remove everything in between, and it takes a lot of time. So that's about what a columnar store is. Now, how do we get the data inside? A little bit of code. First of it, we put our road data, so the topological data, in PostJS, which is just an OGR to OGR command. And the second one you see is entering the data from the floating car data set, which is, in this case, a CSV set. And that ingests directly into the ClickHouse client. Now, then, what do you get? What you see here is the overview of what's in that ClickHouse database in the columnar store. That first row shows the data for roughly 1 month. As I said, 246 gigabytes. That is 32 billion records, just to give you an idea. And to give you an idea about how you query these databases, it just queries exactly the same way as Postgres. It's just an SQL comment you see on the top. But what it does here, the interesting part is on the bottom. You can see what happens. The elapsed time is 7.5 seconds. And what it did, it processed 1.3 billion rows. That is a whopping 960 megabytes per second, which is being processed. Not really, there's tricks in it, of course, but this is the amount of data which theoretically has been parsed. And what you see here is the average speed for every hour on a specific day, and it gives a nice free histogram here. You just get it in your output. Okay, that was code, which was maybe not that interesting. Now we go to some pictures, and this is the part where I use R. First a bit of routing. For you who don't know, you use the PostGIS database to use PG routing on top of it, and you can easily go from point A to point B, which would be done with that simple query over there. In this case, we went along the highway from there to there. And those segments can be combined to the data, which is in the columnar store. What you do is you get the data for that particular road segment out of the database, and then this is what a traffic jam would look like. At 1 o'clock, you see that same route which you took. This is the speed, this is the distance over here. and you see not much is happening. There's one stretch of the highway where you can't go that fast, apparently. There's a maximum on it. If you go to 4 o'clock in the afternoon, the situation is different, and you see dramatic spikes in it, which are obviously traffic jams. Okay. To show you how a traffic jam actually looks like, I found this very nice video. Does it play? Yeah. This is an experiment where they actually create a traffic jam. Watch the white car. This one will be making a traffic jam. It will break at some point. Oh, there it goes. And what you see happening is that the cars continue, but the jam, where they stop, actually moves backwards. So you see it's now over there. And you'll see it's going very quick at some point. So the location where the traffic jam is moving opposite of the direction of the cars. Remember that, because you need it in the next graphs I'll show you. Yeah, this is a slightly complicated one, but once you know it, it's not that difficult. You have time on the bottom scale. You have distance on the vertical one. And the color is the speed. So if you would travel by car in a normal situation, remember the 1 o'clock situation, you travel with a little bit of slower speed on the green part. And basically, you go in a straight line from A to B. If you would travel later, it would look like this. You end up traffic jams, you go slower, and it takes you more time to go from A to B. So obviously, those blue clouds are traffic jams in the speed. And you see the traffic jams actually move the opposite direction of the car direction. What is interesting is that these traffic jams have a constant speed. Now, that's strange. Somebody told me to actually travel in 18 kilometers an hour backwards. That's a fixed speed. There is, however, one line in there, that one, which I couldn't explain. What is that line doing there? Probably it has something to do with this. On this particular day, the weather in the Netherlands looked like this. You see dramatic fronts of rain going through the center here. And my theory was this has something to do, had some influence on the traffic. Now, how do you prove that? You have to load all this radar, rain radar data, into the database. So that's what you see here. This is just to prove it's possible, just believe me. Next thing you do, this goes again into the column store database. It's quite a lot of data. It's every 5 minutes, every kilometer for 2 months. We collected that. So you start summarizing it and see what happens and draw a graph with that. I'm afraid this is the only bit of R code I have in my presentation. And to make it worse, the R code actually consists for 90% of SQL. Maybe that's a good giveaway. SQL is your friend if you're doing R, because what you want to do is you want to remove as much as data as possible before you start putting into an R and processing it. So that's basically what we did. So we cut down already the data into the database and only then moved it to R. The graphs you see are coming straight from R. So this is the end result. You see the same graph on the top again, and on the bottom is the same location. It's again time over here and distance along the road over there. And you see that strange line again over there. And if this is the precipitation in millimeters per minute, per hour, I believe, 8 millimeters per minute sounds like a lot. Then you see there is a yellow band right over there. Now this is I don't have numbers, but this seems like a pretty good fit. I think you would be able to kind of prove that these kind of fronts of weather moving over the country definitely have an influence on your traffic behavior. The reason I showed this is not because I want to prove that the weather has influence on the traffic. I think everybody believes that. The reason is I want to show you how easily this can be done with the use of such a database like ClickHouse database, and really a lot of data, because you really have to look into the data to find these kind of spots. We were in the end able to do this in a matter of minutes to calculate it. And yeah, with this one, I came to the end of the presentation. I think I have time to spare. Oh, great. Thank you very much. First time for a picture. Shall I be on it? Is there any questions?
Yeah, thanks. You mentioned that the ClickHouse is very good for the large data sets. Do you have any kind of estimation what would be kind of a threshold in the gigabytes that is when it's, how to say, reason to use the ClickHouse approach?
To be honest, I think it is not so much about the amount of data, but more the question. Oh yeah, the question was when do you use Postgres and when you go to ClickHouse? So it is more about the kind of data you have that would make you benefit from a column store database. So even if it would be not too much being still thousands of records, of course, but your data is time series, for instance, or sensors, or then I would right away use a column store, unless I need to use advanced geographical queries, which is not enabled in ClickHouse. You need Postgres for that. There is, however, talk about a new in Postgres 13, I believe, maybe 12 even. There might be option to add column store to Postgres itself. Yeah, all the way in the back.
Can I hand it? You say that you used ClickHouse as the column store. Did you try other column stores before choosing ClickHouse, or was it the obvious choice for some reason?
The answer is yes, we did. I used MonetDB, which is a column store database. This is not bad, but it doesn't have as nice support. I mean, the manual is not that readable as ClickHouse was. The installation took a little bit more effort. I used, there's a data wrapper actually in Postgres which also enables a column store. I also used that one. It doesn't match the speed of ClickHouse. If this is the questions, then we have enough time to change rooms, I believe. Thank you very much.